Welcome. We're so glad you're joining us online today. And if you want to join us in person at our 10 a.m. Sunday morning service, you can go to our website and reserve a spot to join us. We're so glad you're here. And if you don't know anything about Cityline, we are the perfect place for imperfect people. So if you're looking for a place to grow and learn more, this is it. When you're with us, you're going to experience passionate worship, challenging messages, and really great community. And you go to our website, you can go to Facebook or YouTube to watch us online to hear more about how to connect. Worship with us. Let's go.
Hey, Cityline, we are so excited to worship with you this morning. We want to encourage you to get up off your couch, dance it out as you sing with us and worship our God today.
Your grace is chasing me down, chasing me down. Goodness and mercy following me. Your grace is chasing me down, chasing me down. Goodness. Separation from you. Your love, your love for me is There's a grace when the heart is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. And when I look to the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There'll be another in the fire standing next to me. There was another in the water holding back the sea. And should I ever need reminding of how I've been set free, there is a cross that bears the burden where another died for me. There is another in the fire. All my debts left for dead beneath the water. Should I fall in the space between what remains of me and this reckoning? Either way, I won't bow to the things of this world. And I know I will never be alone. There'll be another in the fire standing next to me. There is another.
Thank you.
where you'll be. I'll count the joy come every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be.
Hey, Cityline Church, so great to have you tuning into this online experience with us. We are thrilled about what God wants to do in and through your heart today. But we know that God doesn't want to only work in your heart, but He wants to do it in the lives of those that you know. So I want to encourage you to reach out to them, to text them or tag them. Let them know that this feed is available right now and that you would love to invite them to join you for church today. As we continue to worship God, one of the ways that we always worship God here at Cityline is through our giving. We think that giving back to God is central to who we are as followers of Jesus, that we keep Him first in our lives in every area, and that's even including the area of finances. We think that generosity is a way that we honor God. In Cityline Church, I want to thank you for your generosity. Your continued generosity enables us as a church family, as a community of faith, to together make an impact in our cities and our surrounding communities. So let's continue to worship God together.
Too good to let me go. Grateful that you are a God that is always with me through my highest of highs and my lowest of lows, God. And God, I'm so thankful that you are a God who always chases me down and is always there beside me and is always with me, even when sometimes I don't even feel like you are. You are always there. God, I thank you for all these things that you do for me, even when I don't see it. And God, I thank you for loving me. And God, I just pray that you help me and help us as a church to understand how great your love is and learn how to love like you so that we can learn to love others like you do. God, I thank you for all of these things. And we give you all of the praise and all of the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
What an incredible weekend we just experienced. And if I'm being honest, looking back, it's been an incredible year, and we just want to say thank you. Thank you to each and every one of our volunteers who faithfully serve each and every weekend, because honestly, it wouldn't be possible without you. Without those of you who wake up before the sun and get here bright and early to help set up, to the tech team, the worship team, all of you who are serving in Cityline Kids, each and every one of you who take time out of your day to just be a friendly, smiling face as people come on campus, to our videographers and photographers who work so hard behind the scenes to create an incredible experience to help people engage and take next steps with Jesus. We just want to say thank you. We appreciate your yes. We appreciate your commitment to going above and beyond to help people discover and follow Jesus. So once again, thank you so much. God bless you.
Hey there, Cityline parents of little kids. Your Sundays just got better because our toddler room is open again. We're serving children ages 2 to 5 years old. Their spaces are limited, so please go on citylineonline.org to register as soon as you can. See you soon.
Christ's vision for his church has always been a multicultural, multigenerational, redeemed community that serves as a vehicle for God's redemptive love and grace in the world.
A place where people from every ethnic, cultural, socioeconomic background in all walks of life can find connection, purpose, and community.
With Jesus at the center of it all. But that doesn't just happen overnight. In fact, if we're not careful, no, if we're not intentional about it, we could easily fall into the same toxic and divisive systems and attitudes of the worlds around us.
A world that suffers from prejudice, division, and racism. A world that has an us versus them mentality. A world that builds walls, that tries so hard to keep certain people out, and ultimately says that you're either with me or against me.
But here's what we know. Jesus actually gave his life to break down the walls and barriers that a broken humanity created that was far from anything God intended.
As his followers, as the church, we don't have to fall into the trap of picking this side or that side.
Because of Christ, we have a third option.
the things that culture and society say should divide us
will never be greater.
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 Will never be greater than the one thing that unites us, and that is Jesus.
Well, hey, Cityline family, thank you so much for tuning in. We're so excited to have you be a part of this online experience. And it doesn't matter what city, no matter what county, no matter what state that you might be tuning in from, we're honored that you chose to spend time with us today. And if you're new and you're checking us out for the first time, maybe a friend invited you to check out Cityline online, or you kind of stumbled across the feed, we welcome you. We hope it's not your last time with us. We want you to make yourself at home. We hope that you enjoy your time today, because I'll be honest, we think there's no better way to begin or end your day than right here with Cityline online. And today is a great day to be joining us, because today we're going to be jumping into a brand new series of discussions, a conversation that we're calling the third option. And the third option is really a significant conversation for us, because what we're going to be doing over the next few weeks is we're going to be talking about race and reconciliation and the good news of Jesus Christ. And I know some of you, you're like, squirt, like what? Wait, what? Rewind that back, right? Yeah, you heard right. We're going to be talking about race, reconciliation, and the good news of Jesus Christ. And I know for some of you, you're automatically intrigued. You're like, hey, that's great. I'm here for it. I'm ready to go. For others, that makes you incredibly uncomfortable, right? And you're not sure how this is going to go. And the hope is that you'll stick around and kind of check things out. But what we want to do is we want to lean into this topic. We want to lean into this discussion. And we want to do so with the hope that we have in Jesus. The hope in knowing that Jesus can change everything, that the division and the racism and the social issues that we find in our culture and society, right, that those can be radically transformed by the power of Jesus Christ, that those things actually are changed by the church actually living out what it means to be the church, which I know some of you are like, Jack, hold up, time out, but are you sure? Are you sure about this? Are you sure we can talk about this kind of stuff? And my answer is, yes. And I would even go as far as to say we need to, as a church, as the church, to be talking about these very important things. What you have to know about Cityline, though, is this is not a new discussion for us. We are continuing a discussion. That this is not the first time that we're talking about race and reconciliation and racism and diversity and what that looks like as the followers of Jesus, right? This is an ongoing conversation that is a part of who we are, because we understand that our reality is that you can't love Jesus and embrace the good news of Jesus and read your favorite Bible verses without actually talking through some of these things and actually addressing the misunderstandings, addressing the tension that seems to exist. Now, while I recognize that conversations around race and racism and reconciliation, diversity, they can be hard, and sometimes they can feel uncomfortable and awkward, I need you to understand that this is a part of our spiritual growth. This is still very much about emotionally healthy spirituality, and that we are able to actually have these conversations. In fact, I would go as far as to say these conversations are central to the heart of God. So I'm going to ask you over the next few weeks to lean in. I'm going to ask you to not give up on this series. I'm going to ask you to engage in the conversation. I'm going to ask you to be a part of a community group, to join in with others and dialogue and learn and listen together as we engage these topics, right? They're so important. Now, I understand I'm asking you for that, and I get there's going to be some that are going to push back. There's going to be some that are frustrated. There's some that you're about to click off right now, but hold on. Here's what we want you to know, right? This is central not to the heart of God, but it's also central to who we are as Cityline Church. So I'm inviting you to lean in, and I say this with all love. I say this with all honor, and I say this with all respect. If conversations around race and reconciliation and diversity and all those things, as hard as they are, if those are just things that you don't want to be a part of, if they're just things that you're just not ready to lean into, I got to be honest, Cityline may not be the church for you, because this is not going away for us. This is our DNA. This is who we are as followers of Jesus, and we're going to fully live into this. We're going to fully follow Jesus and what he has called us to do, and we're inviting you to come along with us, and our prayer is that you would. But at the same time, I'm going to ask you for grace. I'm going to ask you for grace. I'm going to ask you for patience, right? We're not experts at all of this. Sometimes we're not going to get everything right. Sometimes we're not going to say everything like we should. And then sometimes, you know, we're going to say things that are a bit awkward. We're going to say things that are going to feel very uncomfortable. But I don't want you to give up on it. I want to be clear for those that are listening. This is not a series to call out white people, right? Like, this is not a series that is just geared to get the white people woke, right? Right? This is not even about being woke. I'm gonna talk about that later. But here's what you got to understand. This is not just a black and white issue. In fact, this is not just an Asian hate issue. This is not just a race issue. There's issues of race across all ethnic demographics, right? There's racism, yes, but there's also intra-racism, right? Where whites even have classifications for whites, and African-Americans have different classifications for different statuses of African-American, right? I mean, it happens throughout all of our culture. It's why Hispanics and Puerto Ricans, they don't really get along too well. I mean, there's all these things that are going on in our culture and in our society that continue to dehumanize the very people that God created. Dehumanize the people that have been created in the image of God. But deeper yet, here's what you have to understand. Race is not just the issue. Really, the issue is there's a sin issue. There's a serious sin issue. And the Bible says that all of us, Scripture teaches us that we all have sin. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. So that means that this series really is for all of us. And why is that significant and important for us as a church? Because we want to invite the Holy Spirit to do a radical work in our hearts. We want to invite the Holy Spirit to change our attitude, to change our outlook, to change the way that we go about approaching those in our life who maybe we feel aren't like us, or who are different than us, or who we might not really interact with because we don't really know what to do with that. In fact, it's important for us as a church because we say this all the time. We are a multi-ethnic church. We absolutely are a multi-ethnic church. It's one of the things that makes Cityline beautiful. It's one of the things that people recognize when they come to Cityline. In fact, we believe that the local church is God's primary vehicle or primary resource to transform the world around us. And for us, being a multi-ethnic church, we think is intrinsic to the gospel. To the good news of Jesus Christ. In fact, when people come to Cityline, that's one of the things that they say. I love the diversity at Cityline. I love that there's all kinds of different people groups and ethnicities, and I really love that. But here's what I've learned about that statement. I've learned that if we don't understand what diversity is, if we don't understand the reason why the diversity at Cityline is so important and so significant, that a diverse group of people have been brought together by the love and the power of Jesus Christ, and why that actually matters, then here's what happens. We end up just loving the look of it. We end up just loving the look of it. But understand me, that loving the look of something or having the right language for something does nothing to transform our attitudes or our hearts or our minds in the way that we actually live our lives. We want to live differently because we understand the significance of the diversity that is here at Cityline Church. And how do I know that we've struggled with living through that? How do I know that we struggle with going beyond just a phrase of being multi-ethnic? Well, I would probably call it 2020. I mean, 2020 was a great snapshot. It was a great indication. Right? It was a great indication for me because as a pastor, there are things that we actually had talked about since day one of our existence as a church. So for the last 5 years of being Cityline, we have kind of integrated into the DNA of this community the importance of being a multi-ethnic community, the significance of what that means in being Jesus followers who embrace others, who love God, who love others. But yet 2020 had a way of kind of taking every possible shot and every possible angle that it could to bring what we said we believed to a head. To bring what we said that we believed to a head, not just so that we can continue to either believe in it, but here's the greater thing, so that we could begin to actually live it. But as I watched and as I observed people trying to live it, what I watched was I watched a fair amount of people sit back and absolutely do nothing. I watched a fair amount of people actually sit back and begin to make very unhealthy generalizations. I watched and I observed as others, they got fired up and felt like they needed to do something. And so they joined the protesting, or they began to march. They began to take a stand for the things that they saw as the continued dehumanization of people, the misuse of power, and this cultural outcry during a season of mass political corruption across both sides, dysfunction across all parties and platforms, all the while during this worldwide pandemic where our cultural norms as we know it have been flipped upside down and our world has been radically changed. What do you do? How do you begin to live out the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ and all that? And I feel like what I saw and experienced, I don't know that I was ready for. I saw, you know, whites, Caucasian people being extremely uncomfortable about talking about things of race and being extremely uncomfortable about observing what was going on in our culture and society. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. It's just in their uncomfortable and in their awkwardness, they didn't want to address it. They didn't want to lean in. They wanted to pull back. But there was people that had certain positions and views on law enforcement and how law enforcement was treated in this season. Or maybe they themselves were holding positions of law enforcement where they felt kind of slighted. They felt like people didn't understand the whole story and nobody wanted to know the whole story. There was a lot of people, though, that were thankful that we actually leaned in and began talking about these things and began addressing some of these things and trying to remind people of who the church was in a very difficult and hard season. And yet there were others that maybe would consider themselves people in a certain group that had felt ostracized or felt like the racism was against them, who felt frustrated. Maybe groups of people of color who felt frustrated that we as a church weren't moving fast enough, speaking out quick enough on the issues that were at play in our community. And for me, I'm trying to understand and sympathize with what people are experiencing, what people are going through. And I think I had this moment of realization that in this moment, that the diversity of Cityline Church alone is not enough. That the diversity of Cityline Church is not enough. That if we don't understand the significance of who the church is, if we don't understand the significance of the good news of Jesus Christ, if we don't understand the significance of seeing through a spiritual lens first, before our cultural lens, before our political lens, before whatever thoughts and opinions that we might have, then we end up doing something that every church is in danger of, and that's mimicking the world around us. What am I saying by mimicking the world around us? I'm saying that we end up being divided just like the world around us. We see disunity in our church just like those around us. I mean, it's been said long before this message was ever going to be spoken that one of the most divisive and disunited hours in America is church on Sundays. I mean, you think about that. That shouldn't be. Because here's what I know. All of us, regardless of your ethnicity, we've been affected by issues of race in some way, shape, or form. All of us, regardless of where you've been or where you're from, we have some sort of experience with it. Now, track with me on this. Now, some of you might feel like you're wrongly accused for things that you didn't do, that even happened before you were born, but you're just kind of guilty by association. There's others that you've experienced racism personally, and it's a daily thing that you have to live with, and you didn't do anything to deserve it, but you feel forced to deal with it, right? There's others who actually want to learn how to have a conversation about race because you really care. You really want to love others, but you live in so much fear of saying the wrong thing in the wrong way, and you don't want to further perpetuate the problem. And yet there are still others who you somehow you're finding trying to find a way to deal with the kind of the racial based kind of hate and fear that you feel welling up in your heart and you're not sure what to do about it. My hope is that as we engage this series, we'll begin to process, we'll begin to understand better, we'll begin to lean in and let the Lord work in our heart. You know, a little bit about me as we kind of dive in is that what you may not know about me, if you haven't had a chance to get to know me, is that I'm not originally from LA. I'm not originally from LA County. I'm from San Diego, right? I grew up in San Diego, but probably not the San Diego that everybody thinks of when they go to vacation, right? I'm talking about like South San Diego. I'm talking about driving all the way down the freeway, get down south. And so for me, what you have to understand about me, my upbringing was a little bit different because my upbringing was I was a white kid growing up as a minority. I was a white kid in an area that was vastly diverse. And in fact, some of my first closest friends in my neighborhood was a guy named Chucky, a guy named Mike, Sergio, Jamal, and Derek. Chucky is black, Mike is Mexican, Sergio is Mexican, Jamal is mixed, and Derek is Filipino. I mean, think about this, right? And then there's me, little cinnamon and sugar Jack. You know, Ginger Jack, you know, like running around trying to find my place with all this cultural diversity, but honestly feeling stuck kind of between things, feeling stuck of like who do I identify with? I didn't know very many other white people outside of my immediate family. And it was weird to me because, you know, in our neighborhood, we all hung out, we had a good time, we all played together, you know, everything was good. But then when we went to school, right, something happened at school. Things seemed to be divided. It seemed just kind of like the natural bent of people was that like white people that were there, the few that were there would kind of hang out over here. You know, black people would hang out over here. Mexicans would hang out over here. Asians would hang out over here. I mean, it was kind of like everybody kind of just dispersed to their own. But because I was so used to being around people of color, I felt lost. I didn't know who I identified with because the white kids at my school, I didn't really know them. They didn't live in my neighborhood. I wasn't sure how to interact with them. And then they looked at me because I hung out with a lot of people who weren't like me. And they had picked up on that maybe my talk was a little bit different. And maybe the way that my swag was maybe a little bit different, right? And so they couldn't figure that out. And they just thought that I was trying to be someone that I wasn't. So it didn't matter about their outlook on me. They thought I was trying to be somebody that I wasn't. But then my friends, I mean, it was very clear to them that I wasn't black and I wasn't Mexican and I wasn't Filipino. So where does Jack fit, right? It felt disconnected. It felt like I got to pick and choose somehow. But you know what's fascinating for me is that when I played sports, all those colors and all those things came back together and we functioned together as one. It didn't matter when it came to sports, when we played football, when we played baseball, right? When we got on the basketball court, even though Jack was the last one picked, right? The reality was I was still a part of the team. And we all began to function together. And as I sat back and I began to think about that experience, you know what I realized? That from a very early age, very early on in our life, we're taught to pick a side. We're taught to choose a side. In fact, I want to suggest something up front, that our culture, our society perpetuates racism by wrongly insisting that there's only two options to choose from. In fact, those two options are it's us or it's them. It's got to be us or it's got to be them. It's either you or it's them. It's them or it's they. It's never we. Think about this. In every race conversation, right? In every issue of social conflict, you're asked to pick a side, right? Are you on the white side? Are you on the black side? Are you on the Asian side? Are you on the Hispanic side? Are you on the racist side? Are you on the woke side, right? Are you on the law enforcement side? Are you on the community side? I mean, what side are you on? We might not always recognize it in the moment because our feelings and our emotions are high and everything is going on around us. But division and disunity, that the choosing of sides, that happened long ago. That began a long time ago. And here's what you need to know. That was never God's design. To pick and choose sides was never God's design. In fact, division in our society has been perpetuated by a broken humanity. But we're not the authors of division. In fact, I would say that from the very beginning of time, our spiritual enemy, Satan himself, has done a great job of dividing people, of pitting people against one another, getting people to fight with one another, to argue with one another, to put each other down. Yet God in his love says, I've come to do something different. I've created humanity and I've commissioned humanity to live differently as my family, as my people, as representatives in the world that we live in, that we are to display something radically different by God's power at work in us. In fact, as Jesus followers, as his church, in other words, the translation, as the called out ones, once living a life of sin, that we should look different than our culture and society around us, in our church, outside of our churches, in our homes, on our jobs, wherever we are. In fact, I would say that it's impossible to engage Scripture and not be confronted time and time again with God changing the paradigms that we've created. That God is changing the paradigms by destroying the walls and the barriers that a broken society continue to build and continue to try to erect to create disunity and division among people, God, right, and others. Some of the greatest heroes, though, when you do engage Scripture, some of those people that we look to in our faith is saying like, wow, these people really made a difference. I mean, some of those people, they learned how to overcome the us versus them mentality. They knew that there was a better way. They knew that there was a different way. In fact, one of those guys is a guy named Joshua. Some of you might remember Joshua's story. We talked about him several months ago. In fact, in Joshua chapter 5, Joshua is getting ready for the battle of Jericho. And he's going out and he's surveying the land because he understands that God is going to take them into the promised land. And as God begins to take them into the promised land, what God is going to do is God's going to work in some great ways that are only going to happen by God's power. It's not going to be because of Joshua's power. It's not going to be because of the army of Israel's power. It's going to be because of God's power. But as Joshua is out surveying the land, listen to what happens. Verse 13 in chapter 5. Now, when Joshua was near Jericho, he looked up and he saw a man standing in front of him with a drawn sword in his hand. Joshua went up to him and he asked him a very important question. Are you for us or for our enemies? Did you get that? Are you for us or are you for our enemies? Joshua sees this man standing there with his sword drawn. Joshua, with all boldness, goes up and says, hey, are you for us or for them? That's our cultural perspective. That's our societal perspective. It's either us or them. You're either for us or you're against us. That's what the enemy would want you to believe. You're either for us or you're against us. So are you for us or are you for them? But listen to the response. Neither, says the man. Neither, he replied. But as commander of the army of the Lord, I have now come. He says, hold up. Joshua says, I don't think you understood. Are you for us or for them? He says, no. No, it's not an answer. He said, okay, neither. Yeah. Well, what do you mean? Yeah, I'm for neither. I'm the commander of the Lord's army. As soon as he heard the Lord's army, the commander of the Lord's army, Joshua fell face down to the ground in reverence, meaning he began to worship, and he asked, what message does my Lord have for his servants? Now, scholars think that in this moment, that this was a revelation of God. This was a picture of God. This was Jesus, right? Physically present right there with Joshua, right? Showing that hey, God's about to do something new. God is up to something new. God has been working since Genesis 1. He's still doing a new thing. So what message does the Lord have for his servant? Listen to this message. The commander of the Lord's army replied, take off your sandals, for the place that you're standing is holy. And Joshua did so. Circle that, underline that, right? This place is holy. In other words, it's not us and them. It's not your ground and their ground. There is a third option, and that is holy ground. Well, what am I saying? The third option is not your way or their way. You know, it's not our way or your way. There's a third option that says, you know what? We're going to do things God's way, right? God is going to lead. God is going to take control. We're going to surrender to God. Why? Because God is a God of love. He's a God of compassion. He's a God of justice. It's the only way that things are going to change in our community, in our society, is by God's power at work in and through his people. Now, don't get me wrong. Sure, there are laws. They can always change, right? Politics, that needs to change, right? You know, but real and lasting, sustainable change can only come by the power of Jesus Christ. It's not your way. It's not their way. It's not just what I want. It's that I surrender what I want and I choose to say, I want what God wants. I want God to have his way. I want God's justice. I want God's love. I want God's compassion. I want God's restoration. I want God's reconciliation right here, right now. I want as it is on earth, as it is in heaven, right? That's choosing the third option. Right? Choosing God's third option says that this invites us to honor one another, to honor that which makes us united, to honor the fact that there is the presence of God's image in each and every person that we meet. In each and every person that we meet, they have been made and created in the image of God. So I'm choosing to align myself with God's way so that I begin to see people in a different way. You know what our problem is, though? Our problem is that we don't naturally gravitate towards unity and diversity. We just don't. We tend to naturally gravitate towards homogeny or sameness. We do what's most comfortable, right? In fact, social psychologists would say that people tend to kind of wrap themselves around a group dynamic. They kind of categorize themselves and divide themselves up by certain categories. In fact, for today, we'll just call them an in-group and an out-group. If you're taking notes, I hope you write that down. There's an in-group and an out-group. In other words, it's identifying others in groups that are either like me or they're not like me, creating an us versus them mentality. Either you're like me or you're not like me. Either you're for me or you are against me. And don't get me wrong, the groups are not just racially based, right? These groups are endless. I mean, it's white, it's black, it's brown, it's guys, it's girls, it's Republicans, it's Democrats, it's jocks, it's nerds, it's band geeks, it's gamers, right? It's retired, it's rich, it's poor. I mean, you name it, there's all kinds of groups that people tend to want to identify with. And the reality of the human heart is that no matter what color you are, no matter what ethnicity you are, all of us are geared towards drifting towards homogeneous groups because it's easier than embracing diversity. It's easier and less messy and less scary to just go with what you know. So it's easier to say, hey, I'm just going to choose the easy button. What's the easy button? Well, that's my in-group. What's my in-group? My in-group are people who are like me. They're just like me, right? They're people who I identify with. They're my crew. They're my tribe, right? They're my community. I mean, they're safe. They're easy. You know, we act alike. We talk alike. We look alike. We walk alike. We got everything in common. Like the commonality is so amazing that it makes us feel so good because, well, that's my in-group. But then the adverse of that is my out-group, which is people who are not like me, right? The not like me group. Or another way you can say that, it's the others. It's the thems. It's the those people. Oh, those people. Yeah, that's my out-group. However you have decided to define those people, they're not like you. They don't look like you. They don't act like you. They don't talk like you. They don't dress like you. You don't think that there's a real connection. In fact, you've defined them by maybe their looks or maybe their status or maybe their politics. And you define them in that way so that they don't ever get in your in-group, that you can keep them in your out-group. You want to keep them separate, right? And so now we begin to create this social narrative that we begin to live our life by. And this social narrative is the lens in which we see our world, the lens in which we relate with people. And here's what happens. In our out-group, we know very little information realistically about our out-group. We don't know a lot about our out-group, but we have observed enough, or we've inferred enough, or we've assumed enough to get this, to create a stereotype. And because we've created a stereotype, we'll utilize that stereotype as the way that we view them and the reason why we keep them out. In fact, I want to show you this in Scripture, Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 10. Acts is a phenomenal story of this early church, right? The first century church. Jesus comes, he gives his life, he dies on the cross, he's raised a new life. He empowers his church. The church is growing. Thousands of people are coming to know Jesus. And as thousands of people are coming to know Jesus, you know, they're dealing with real conflict. They're dealing with real issues. And there's issues of racism. There's issues of class differentiation, right? There's socioeconomic conflicts that are going on with this body of believers. Now, Peter is one of the leaders in the church. And as Peter being one of the leaders in the church, he's one of the main people speaking about this good news. Now, there's a guy who is a Roman centurion named Cornelius who hears about Peter, who hears about the good news of what's going on. Again, he's an Italian guy from Rome, right? A Roman centurion working for the Roman government, this oppressive government that was oppressing the Jews. But yet there's something so intriguing about this message that suddenly he has this moment where he feels like God has impressed upon his heart that he needs to send for Peter. Peter has to come to our house and has to tell us this good news about Jesus Christ. Yet there's a problem. Peter has been taught all of his life that Jews, good God-honoring Jews, that you don't associate with Gentiles, right? You don't want anything to do with Gentiles. Gentiles are considered unclean. They're those people. They're on the outskirts. And you want to stay far away from those people. Yet at the same time that God is working on Cornelius's heart, God is also working on Peter's heart. And in a dream, Peter has this understanding where God shows him a table with all kinds of food that had been considered unclean. Unclean to Jewish culture and custom. You don't eat those things because it'll make you unclean. God sets the table for him, not before him, not once, not twice, but three times. And every time Peter is like, no, God, I'm not going to eat that. And God says, Peter, I'm asking you to eat. He says, God, I would never do that. I would never do anything to sin against you. I would never do anything to make myself unclean or holy. I would never eat those kinds of foods. To which God's response is, who are you to call something unclean? If I've not called it unclean, you have no right to call it unclean. There's a moment of realization that Peter has that God is up to something, that God is doing something in his heart. When Peter wakes up from his dream, guess who's knocking on his door? It's Cornelius's tribe, right? Cornelius's guys who have sent for Peter to come bring the message back to Cornelius and the people in his home. Now there's this Jew and Gentile conflict that suddenly they're staring at each other in the face. Now, Jew and Gentile doesn't really rub us the right way, you know, because like we think, well, we're so far removed from biblical times. But if we say this is a white or black conflict or this is a white versus Asian conflict or whatever that is, then it becomes a lot more unsettling. But Acts chapter 10, right? Peter decides that, you know what, if God is up to something and God is doing something, I'm going to lean into it. And he chooses to go with Cornelius. We arrive at Acts chapter 10, verse 28. He says to them, this is Peter. Peter walks into Cornelius's house, right? Filled with nothing but Gentiles. And he walks in there and he says, you all are well aware that it's against our law for a Jew to associate and visit a Gentile. He says, let me just give you a blanket statement. I shouldn't even be here. Why? Because you guys are my out-group. You're in my out-group. You're not my in-group. The good Jewish people are my in-group, but you Gentiles are the out-group. And you know that we've got laws and customs. We've got all kinds of things that have caused division. And that says, you know, we keep you guys on the outskirts. He says, but God has shown me that I should not call anyone impure or unclean. God's shown me something different. Peter is saying that God has shown me that he's beginning to break down the walls and the barriers that exist. He's beginning to create this new family of God that's marked by unity, marked by diversity. But Peter's honestly describing what happens in our culture. He's describing what happens to us, where we keep certain people in and we want to push certain people out. We want to categorize certain people and we want to decategorize other. In other words, it's called this in-group bias. The in-group bias, where we have the tendency to give preferential treatment to people considered to be like me. That I'm biased towards my in-group. Peter says, you know, I'm a good Jewish guy. I'm just trying my best to follow God. And I'm not even supposed to hang out with Gentiles. But you know what? I guess I'm here because God is up to something, right? When we have in-group bias, let's be honest, it's the very things that continues to fuel the division and disunity, racism and cliques that we find in our culture. Peter walks into the room, and usually Peter would look around and say, oh, who do I identify with? Let me find the good Jewish people to hang out with because I'm not hanging out with the Gentiles. But in this case, something different happens to Peter, to which some of you would say, well, I don't know that I really do that. I don't know that I have an in-group bias. Well, let's just check for a second, just some characteristics that you can jot down just in case you're wondering if you're there, right? I mean, sometimes we feel like for our in-group bias, well, we're biased to our in-group because we're most comfortable with those who are like me. We're more inclined to spend time with those who are like me. We're more patient to give the benefit of the doubt more quickly to those who are like me. We tend to give more grace, communicate easier, and assume that we'll get along better with those who are like me, right? And that I'm more willing to go out of my way to help those who are exactly like me. See, do you see the issue? Do you see the tension? Peter walks in and he says, I'm going to pursue this third option. I'm going to pursue holy ground, that God is showing me that there is something different, that it's not about me versus you or us versus them. It's about what God is doing and I am on holy ground. How do we know he was on holy ground? Listen to this. Peter begins to open up his mouth. And he begins to talk about the good news of Jesus Christ to people who were far, to people who were considered less than, to people that were considered these Gentiles that were unclean and untouchable. And suddenly in verse 44, I love this. Verse 44 says that while Peter was still speaking these words, while Peter was still sharing the message of the good news, the Holy Spirit came upon all who heard the message. Think about that. How awesome would that be? That's my hope, to be honest with you, right? Like that I would be speaking a message one day, and I don't even get into my second point yet. I'm not even done with my intro, and that the Holy Spirit would just suddenly fall upon people, that God would begin to pour himself out. Peter's in this moment where he's speaking these words. The Holy Spirit came upon all who heard the message, and then listen to what happened. It says, the circumcised believers who had come with Peter, they were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out upon the Gentiles. For they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Wait, time out. What's going on? Speaking in tongues and praising God. Understand, this is not the scriptures trying to freak you out. You know, when you come to church, that suddenly people are going to be speaking in tongues, you know, because of the power of the Holy Spirit. No. What this is understanding that the Jewish people, right? That God said Jesus gave his life. And Jesus gave his life. He's resurrected now. He says in Acts chapter 2, go to the upper room. Wait for me. You're going to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. That is going to be your commissioning now to go out and to share the good news, right? To let others know about the good news and the love of Jesus Christ. And he says that when you are empowered with that, guess what's going to happen? We read the story. They are empowered with the Holy Spirit. They begin to speak in other tongues so that other nations, other tribes could hear and know the good news. It wasn't just a heavenly language. It was a physical language that other people looked on and said, how do these Jewish people know the language that I speak? God is about a God of diversity. He's a God of unity. He's a God who wants to reach all people groups, all nations. Now, God shows up on the scene in Acts chapter 10, and the people who were thought to be outskirts, outcasts, right? Untouchable. God shows up, and the same power of the Holy Spirit with the same evidence of them speaking in tongues shows up right here to the Gentiles. And then Peter says, well, surely no one can stand in the way of them being baptized with water. They have received the Holy Spirit just as we have. And so he ordered that they be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. And then they asked Peter to stay with them for a few more days. Woo! I'm so fired up right now. Isn't that so powerful? I mean, think about that. They asked Peter to stay with them a few more days because God was doing some amazing things. I mean, they were having like legit revival right there. It was an amazing experience. Why? Because Peter was willing to get beyond the us versus them mentality. Peter was willing to allow God to crush the barriers, to break down the walls. Peter was allowing himself to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. And as he began to share the good news of Jesus Christ, things begin to change when we begin to share the good news of Jesus Christ, right? People can't just stay unhindered by this good news. Something happens inside of them. The Holy Spirit was poured out, and great things were happening right then and there as people came to know Jesus. Peter stays with them a few more days. He heads back to Jerusalem, and we arrive at Acts chapter 11. It's very interesting. Acts chapter 11, right? Like Peter, he's going back up to Jerusalem, it says. And then suddenly there was the circumcised believers that were there. As the apostles and the believers throughout Judea heard the Gentiles had also received the word of God. So there's something that happened, right? The apostles and believers, they'd heard about what was going on at Cornelius' house, right? And they had some thoughts about it. Goes on, it says this. Luke says in Acts chapter 11, verse 2, he says that when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcised believers criticized him and said, you went into the house of uncircumcised men and ate with them? Understand, they didn't say, Peter, that was so amazing. I heard that the power of the Holy Spirit was poured out upon the Gentiles, and they too began to speak in tongues as evidence that God and his power was at work and alive in them, and God was doing something around them. No. You know what they said? Peter, are you for real, bro? Like, have you forgot who you are? Have you forgot who your in-group is and who your out-group is? I mean, did you really go to their house? One, and did you actually eat with them, Peter? I mean, Peter, why would you actually do that? See, this is crazy when you think about it. But I love what Peter does. Peter pushes back. Peter stands tall. Peter, not being known for his spine or his backbone, right? He actually stands tall and says, no. God's doing something new. God's shown me a different way. It's not us versus them. There's a third option. That is holy ground. And when I fully leaned into that, God did the amazing. But they can't grasp it. And they can't understand it. Why? Because understand this. When you find your in-group, and you identify yourself with your in-group, there now comes all kinds of pressure to act according to the rules of your in-group. And if for some reason you don't act according to the rules of your in-group, then you're perceived as either being wrong or you have the potential of being a sellout. And nobody wants to be a sellout. And if you're a sellout, here's what's happening. You're in danger now of losing your in-group rights. We're going to revoke them from you, right? We're going to take your white card. We're going to take your black card or whatever other membership card that you feel like you've subscribed to. You know what that's called? That's called out-group discrimination. You've got in-group bias, but you also have out-group discrimination. It's withholding in-group bias from those that are not like me. These circumcised believers, right? They can't believe that Peter ate with them because they're like, whoa, hold up. They're not us. They're not a part of the in-group. They're not the ones that we're most comfortable with. They're not the ones that we love to hang out with. They're not the ones that we extend grace to. They're not like us. How do I know that maybe some out-group discrimination maybe exists in my life? Again, just some characteristics, just some signs for simple assessment is that often we're less comfortable with those who are not like me, and we know it. We're less inclined to spend time with them because we don't feel so comfortable. We're less patient and willing to give them the benefit of the doubt, right? We always got our stereotype in mind that's saying this is why they did what they did, right? But we don't communicate well, nor do we extend grace with those people because we don't see the need to. And then we often just automatically assume that, you know what? We're so different that we don't have anything in common anyway. You know what's so fascinating about not having anything in common? We're a lot more alike than we are different. Did you know that if we strip away the exterior layer of who we are, a skin and features, that genetically we're 99.5% exactly the same? Yeah, 99.5% exactly the same. That's why when you go to get blood, you don't care where the blood's coming from. Why? Because it can come from any other ethnicity. As long as it is your blood type, it works in your body. Why? Because we're 99.5% the same. If you needed a certain body part, you needed a kidney, right? You needed a transplant of some sort. You do not care what ethnicity it comes from. Why? Because when you strip the exterior away, when you strip the features away, inside we are 99.5% exactly the same. But understand, intentional or unintentional, right? When we have this kind of discrimination at work in our life, we're only perpetuating the ongoing division and divisiveness in our culture. And there's something that you and I need to understand, that racial division and social bias are in direct opposition of the heart of God and the good news of Jesus Christ. It's in direct opposition of the good news of Jesus Christ. We just celebrated Easter. And Easter comes with some implications. The cross comes with some implications because at the cross, we understand that Jesus, he gave his life, not for some people, not for just those people, not for us or for them. He gave his life for all, which means that at the cross, there is level ground. At the cross, there is equality. At the cross, there is equal footing. But understand, at the cross, that is holy ground. That is saying there's going to be a new way, a different way. It's no longer an us versus them mentality. It is about God's way and aligning my life with him. And the resurrection now says that the implications that come with that is the resurrection power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead now lives in you and me. And it empowers us to actually live out this God-honoring life, that we live into the third option, to God's option. We live a God-honoring life, doing the things that God has actually called us to do. And why can't we say there's a third option? Well, why can't we say that we as a church, that we could be different and things can look different in our culture? It's simply because this, Paul says it in Ephesians chapter 2. This is so powerful, starting in verse 13. He says, "But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near by the blood of Jesus Christ." You once were far. You once were a part of the out-group, right? You were a long way away from God. You were disconnected from God. But by the blood of Jesus, you've been brought near. He goes on, he says, "For he himself is our peace." And here's what he did. He made the two groups one. Hear me again. He made the two groups one. Say it one more time. He made the two groups one. He made us versus them. We. It's we, right? He made it one. Understand that is so important. He said he made the two groups one, and he's destroyed the barrier and the dividing wall of hostility by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and its regulations. His purpose was to create in himself, understand this, one new humanity. Say it again. One new humanity. In other words, there's not races. There's only one race, and that's the human race. Yes, there are ethnicities, and yes, there are differences that we can embrace and that we can celebrate. But the reality is we are one in Jesus Christ. He's destroyed the barriers between you and I, us and them. It is we, God's people, out of the two, thus making peace and in one body to reconcile both of them, understand, back to God through the cross by which he put to death their hostility. We are reconciled to God, and we are now reconciled to one another. Why? Because of Jesus Christ. In other words, the gospel invades the space of confusion and tension that brings on now peace and unity. The gospel heals. The gospel reconciles. The gospel begins to restore, right? It has the power to put back together something that is broken. It pieces it back together and makes it stronger and way more beautiful than it was before. How do we continue to live into that? How do we know, and knowing that Jesus has done something about the problem, and knowing that Jesus has come to crush sin, which, by the way, racism is a sin of the heart issue. Romans 3:23 says that we all have sinned. That means all. That means white, black, Latino, Asian, Middle Eastern, and everything in between. That the racism is an equal opportunity offender. It's a human condition that affects all people, but Jesus has done something about it. Jesus came to bring change. Jesus destroyed those things. Now it's up to us to no longer live into it. To no longer choose us versus them, but to choose holy ground. To choose the third option, where we understand that we are a redeemed community, where the things that culture and society say should divide us, they'll never ever be greater than the one thing that unites us, and his name is Jesus. And it is our hope as we track over these next few weeks that whatever circle or group you feel like you've identified yourself by that's outside of anything other than child of God or saved by grace, that you would choose to step out of that group and choose to surrender your life, step into the mentality of unity and peace and wholeness that comes by the power and forgiveness and grace of Jesus Christ in your life, because we were designed to live in unity. God honoring, mutual honoring, love and unity with one another. And we've been commissioned to heal a broken and fractured world, because God is a God of restoration. How do we lean in? How do we lean in? I'm going to give you just five quick things. We don't have a lot of time to unpack this, but it's going to give you a snapshot of where we're going over the next few weeks, because I'm encouraging you. I want you to lean in. But where do we start when it comes to the third option? Where do we start about taking some next steps? You're hearing things today. You're hearing about in-group and out-group, and you're hearing about in-group bias and out-group discrimination, and you're seeing it lived out in Scripture, but you're seeing that God has provided a different way. So what are some steps that you and I can take? I want to give you five things that I hope you'll write down. And here's what I'm going to ask you to do about these things. Would you begin praying about them this week? Would you begin dialoguing through these things this week with your community groups? Maybe you just need to get with another person and begin to talk with them one-on-one about some of these things. The first is this. Maybe we begin with repentance as we acknowledge our potential blind spots. We just begin with repentance as we acknowledge the blind spots. Everybody has blind spots. Everybody has blind spots. And sometimes we don't know that we're doing things that are further perpetuating the divisiveness and disunity. We don't realize that there are certain things that we say. There's certain phrases that we use. There's certain actions that we take that are further pushing people away, not just from connection with us, but from connection with Jesus Christ. Understand this, that we all have blind spots, but acknowledging our blind spots, being willing to learn about those blind spots, leads us to a place of repentance. And understand this, repentance is a gift. Repentance is a gift because repentance is saying that I'm sorry, and guess what? I'm going to turn from doing those things. I'm going to recognize those blind spots, and I'm going to begin to live differently. That while culture may have shaped the way I view people and their status and their race and all that stuff, and there's blind spots in my life, I'm going to expose my heart to God and allow Him to show me something different. The other one is this. Maybe we rename they and those people with brother and sister because we're family. We just rename those people. Right? There's no more those people. It's no more my outgroups. No more they. Well, they. Whoever's they. Well, it's those people that are doing these things that I don't like and that I don't approve of. And that you might not like it and you might not approve of it and you might not do that, but there is nothing that's stopping you from loving them. There's nothing that's stopping you from praying for them. But the only way that you can love them or pray for them is to understand that they're your neighbor. Remember the Good Samaritan, right? Who is my neighbor? See, sometimes we want to try to define who our neighbor is, because if we can define who our neighbor is, if we can define our in-group, then here's what happens. We begin to put labels on our out-group. And if we put some strong labels on our out-group, guess what? We give ourselves permission not to love them anymore. That's not godly. That's not what God is calling us to do. That's not the love of God. We are to love God, to love others, and we love others as we love ourselves, just as we love our in-group. Why? Because being a neighbor says they are my brother, they are my sister, they are made in the image of God, and they deserve my love, my prayer, and my honor. Third is this. Maybe we give some in-group love to your out-group. Give some in-group love to your out-group. I would even challenge you today, you know, like as you come to church, you know, as you hang out at one of our outdoor services, or you hang out with other people. Sometimes it's so easy, even when we come to church, to just gravitate towards the same people all the time. You got your same little crew. You got your same little clique. You got your same people that you hang out with. You come in and you feel so comfortable. I just want to gravitate to them. And you know what? You know nobody else. You don't talk to anybody else. Right? You don't seem to care a whole lot about anybody else. Why? Because we got a whole lot of love for our in-group, but when it comes to our out-group, why do they matter? God would challenge you today to rethink that maybe you should give that same kind of love, that same kind of grace, that same kind of compassion, that same kind of treatment to those who are not like you, those who you don't know, those who you don't have a great relationship with. Another one is to acknowledge the people as unique image bearers of Christ. You and I have all been made in His image and His likeness. And it doesn't matter what people are doing, what they've done. It doesn't matter if you disapprove, like I said, of all the things that they're doing. The reality is they too have been made in His image. And they too may be far from God right now, but they too can be brought near. Why? Because of Jesus. How will they know about the love of Jesus? Well, it's by your love for them, honoring the image of God in them. And lastly, we need to view every conversation as a learning opportunity as you open your heart to those who aren't like you. It's a learning opportunity. In fact, I would challenge you this week to step out of your in-group and have a conversation with somebody who you see as your out-group. Find a person of color and just say, hey, can you tell me your story? And I know the people of color are like, great, pastor, like, why'd you tell them to do that? Now I'm gonna have like five people trying to take me to coffee. There's a pandemic still. I understand, I get it. Give us some patience, right? Like we're trying to learn here. We're trying to grow somewhere. We're trying to understand each other. And I think the way that we do that is we're willing to have a conversation. We're willing to lean in. We're willing not to shy away from it. Because at the end of the day, this is what Jesus prayed for. He prayed for unity. He prayed that we would be one. Before Jesus gave His life on the cross, knowing that this is what He was going to do, He prays and asks God, God, my prayer is that we would be one, just as You and I are one. Our prayer at Cityline Church is that we would learn how to be one. And because of the work that God is doing in our heart, our world begins to look a lot different. Would you bow your heads and let's pray. Father, thank You for today. Thank You for Your love, Your grace, Your mercy. God, I thank You, God, that You care so much for us. God, I thank You for this conversation that we can have as a church, that we don't have to shy away from it. We don't have to ignore it. We don't have to push away from the table, God, but we can lean into it. And Father, I pray that that's exactly what You would help us to do. That You would help us to lean into the awkwardness, lean into the uncomfort. Lord God, lean into the issues that need to be addressed, God, as we learn more about You. Lord, as we come alongside one another, Lord, as we allow You to continue to tear down the walls, tear down the barriers, tear down the things, Lord, that have so easily divided us and caused disunity. God, your heart is that your church would be united and that your united church, God, would bring change to the world, that we are world changers. And so, Father, I pray that we would take that responsibility seriously, God, that we would fully lean into it, God, and that we too, just like Peter, would see a revival. God, that we too, just like Peter, would see an outpouring of your Holy Spirit, Lord God, as you do what only you can do. So, Father, change our hearts. We give you glory, honor, and praise in advance. Amen.
Things, but
thank you, God. We know that the victory is already won. God, you've never lost a battle. Not even the things that we look at in our world and we can't imagine how we're ever gonna get out of these battles, God. You've already won. And you're the one that unites us. God, our prayer is that we look to you first, that we seek you first, so that we can be united with each other in you, in your family, in your kingdom, in your love and your grace and your mercy, and that we can see each other the way you see us. Please help us with that, God. And thank you. Thank you for loving each and every one of us, imperfect people, in your mighty and matchless name. We pray. Amen.
Thank you so much for joining us. We really hope that you were encouraged today. If you'd like to learn more how to connect, you can go to our website. You can visit us on the Cityline app. And we can't wait to worship with you next week. Please come back.